I greet each and every one of you in the precious name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Thank God for Brother Solomon. Happy to see you, my brother. You know, as believers, we have to always have a way to prove that God is who He says He is in our personal life. Nobody's testimony is good for the other. But Abraham's testimony is not good enough for me. Because I am a child of God. My testimony is not good enough for you. You have to have your testimony. You can't call God a father and have no relationship with Him. God doesn't have grandchildren. We are all His children. That means you have to have evidence that He is your Father. Amen? So when certain things come our way, it is an evidence to prove to yourself that truly God is your Father. Hallelujah? Blessed be the name of the living God. This morning, see, let me have a little bit of song. I will work so much on this sound system. We keep working on it until we get it perfect. But you love the Lord? Amen. At least we are doing something. Amen? Amen? Thank God for the young man, Dave. You know, I bought the instrument and he's able to hook it up so that all the mics are speaking. It just, the mics, I think, is the issue. Eventually, we get some mic that will be of a top quality. But for now, I think the sound system is coming up there. Thank God. Hallelujah. There's nothing I enjoy doing more than anything I do here. I hope you do the same. When I come to the house of God, I feel like a little baby. I'm always looking for something to do. You probably noticed that. I'm restless. I'm always looking for something to do. There's nothing in this world that gives me joy. I hope you've come to that point too. If you have not, I pray you come to that soon. There's no joy in this world. There's nothing this world has to offer any one of us as a Christian. We can sit down and spend the whole day, and if I can't prove it to you, then I don't know who else can. I will let you know that there's nothing you're seeking, that when you find it, you'll be happy. Nothing. Except God. This is the only source of happiness. Listen to the news. Young men are dying. Celebrities are dying. Superstars are dying. They are 40, they are 50. Is it money that they don't have? But their life is void. Oh, by the way, a testimony to the song that the kids sang this morning. These little children. So on Friday after we finish service, I was going back there to get my bag, and Michael was standing there singing this song. He sang it very well. He was humming it. So I said, Michael, can you guys sing this song today? And I pleaded with Corinthia and organized them, and they sang it. God bless you, Brother Michael. See, these kids, the environment you create, I'm telling you, he just sat there, was a dancing and singing by himself. I said, wow. And I sat there watching him because I enjoy things like that. Amen? This is how the Spirit of the Lord works. He can just take a hold of a little kid, because remember, we have to call him like a little children. Just take a hold of a little kid and he begin to minister. He was ministering to my soul. I was watching him. We've had a wonderful prayer meeting, but that little song he was singing there caught my attention. And I just sat there watching this little boy. Nobody told him to sing it. Nobody's leading him. He's just going on by himself. Hallelujah. That's what I love to see. Because when you train these children this way, friends, if all our achievement is that we raise these children in the fear and admonition of the Lord, we are done. Amen? Amen? You may not hear a wonderful sermon. You may not see thunder coming down from preaching, but because these little children, they learn something that if Christ tarries, they will now continue to be Christians and pursue the ways of Christ, so that when it's all over, we'll all be together. Is there anything more than that? That is the greatest accomplishment. But Abraham, beyond the curtain of time, when he got there, he said, he saw his horse, he saw his dog, and then people challenged him. How can you tell me you have horses in heaven? They wrote it in the businessman publication. And Brother Abraham said, well, brother, I didn't tell you I was in heaven. I told you I was in a place where I asked for Christ. And Brother Abraham was told Christ is still a little up. He said, but if this will make you happy, in the book of Revelation, it is written that when Jesus Christ was coming down, he was on a white horse. And he was coming from the heavens of heaven. From the heavens of heaven, on a white horse, and the host of heaven was riding with him. Hallelujah. And the voice told Abraham, everyone you love will be with you. I give you back everyone you love. Friends, that includes me, because he loves me and I love him. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. By the word, you become one. So friends, when you're doing what you're doing, you're laboring, you're coming here, God bless you, Sister Zoe, you're driving a long distance and bringing your family, you know, and you're coming over and you have in your heart, I'm going to the house of the Lord because there's something there for me. Hallelujah, it's not in vain. Hallelujah, it's not in vain. Glory. This morning, we have about 5 different messages that we're going to cook. But Patrick, you know how we cook, buffet. We're going to cook 5 messages for about 1 hour. We're going to cook them, steam them very well. And I pray we do you good and do me good. Hallelujah. 5 different messages by the grace of the living God. But we're going to sum those 5 messages into the gospel effects. The effect of gospel. So if you want to title it, your title is Gospel Effects. What is the effect of the gospel? See, on Friday, we talked about gospel sound on Friday. The sound of the gospel. We talked on it on Friday. And we used the scripture in the book of Numbers, where Miriam and Aaron was asking Moses a question. They asked him, does God only speak to you? God also speaks to them, they claim. And because of that, Miriam got leprosy. Because God came down and said, yes, I spoke to only Moses at this time. He said, are you not afraid of me? He said, if there be one among you who is a prophet, if there be one among you, I will speak to him in dream and in vision. He said, but with Moses, I was speaking to him mouth to mouth. Are you not afraid? And the glory of the living God came down. And the whole tabernacle was filled with his presence. And the voice spoke. He said, voice! God speaks. When God speaks, you will know that God is speaking. So this morning, we are going to see the effect of that gospel. Hallelujah. Let us see, we're going to take one of the scriptures from the several messages I mentioned to you. And in terms of title, young girls, pay attention so you can jump from message to message. This morning, the first message we should open up will be a trumpet gives an uncertain sound. When a trumpet gives an uncertain sound, then what shall it do to the people? It was preached 1963. It was preached January 14, 1963. A prophet giving a trumpet giving an uncertain sound. And the scripture there is 1 Corinthians 14:8. It's preached January 14, 1963. So let's just read the scripture for that message, and that will set the scripture for the rest of the messages. That once you get it, 1 Corinthians 14 to verse, chapter 14, verse 8, let's just bow in our heads in prayer. My Lord, my God, Father, here we are in your presence, for your promise, that we 2 or 3 are gathered together in your name, there you shall be. There is no way one can prepare to preach a message because the preparation is you. There is no way one can speak if you have not spoken. We don't want to have our own thoughts or own natural understanding. I want everything to come from you. How we love you, dear Jesus, my Lord. For you gave us a prophet. How we love our precious brother, William Marion Brown, the life that he lived, the gift that he had, the time that he spent on earth, he used it wisely. And because of that, Lord, the gospel light has shined. We have seen the light. We are happy, my Lord. We are most precious, my Lord. We are very grateful, my Lord. Oh, there is no word in the English tonight to thank you for what you have done. But this morning, my Lord, I'm praying, dear Jesus, that you minister unto us using the very gospel. For that day you said, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me and has anointed me to preach good news, to deliver those that are untrodden, to set the captives free. For this is the purpose of the gospel, that we shall be free, free from bondage, free from sin, free from every evil, free from every curse, free from every what, every power that is contrary to the power of the living God, free from the powers of darkness, free from every sickness, free from every abuse, free from whatsoever that is contrary to the blessings of God. We are free because you said so, that whom the Son of God set free, he is free indeed. Mighty Jesus, come in the fullness of your glory and take a hold of this moment. May the words that will come from these tattered lips, these lips of Martha, may it be a blessing to somebody. May it increase somebody's faith. For this is the purpose of the gospel. This is the effect of the gospel. That we can become who you are. As our sins are forgiven. And you see them no more. Precious Lord, I yield my strength, my thoughts, my essence of being, whatsoever that is within me. May it glorify you this morning. I present to you, my Lord, our church, my brothers, my sisters. We are here in one accord, not greater than the other, but the children of the Most High, to plead our case, to thank you for who you are, to honor your holy name. May you visit everyone, my Lord, in a special way. May the sick be healed. May the downtrodden spirit be lifted up. May those who are needy be provided for. May you satisfy the heart of everyone, because you are their God, you are their provider, you are their Lord, you are the giver of everything good. Oh my God, my Lord, I know you will do this because you deserve the glory. You want to be glorified. May our life glorify you. May they speak with their lips of what you have done. May they testify to the goodness of the living God for your name's sake. My Lord, my God, come now, my Lord, as you always do, when the message is being preached, when my prophet was alive, as you always do, when you begin to speak the word, the angel of the living God will come and uphold, and uphold. May you come this morning. 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 May you come this morning in the fullness of your glory and glorify your name among your children for your name's sake. Lord, we are able. You are more than able. You are more than able. We are just waiting in anticipation that you have done it. And we pray with thanksgiving in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Amen. For if the trumpet give an uncertain sound, who shall prepare himself to battle? May the Lord bless you in his word. You may have your seats. Hallelujah. May God help us to go through these messages this morning the way that he has it. And I'm going to spread them out here. Hallelujah. And by way of a sentence, sometimes I like to put a sentence together I put this sentence, the dashboard is shattered. This sentence has messages in them. If you're listening, you can catch them. The gospel is certain, simple, and transforms when accepted and acted upon. I repeat that. The gospel is certain. So one of the messages this morning you just read is about a trumpet giving an uncertain sound. But the gospel is certain. It's not uncertain. But and it's simple. And one of the messages this morning is God hiding himself in simplicity. The gospel is simple and it transforms. One of the messages this morning is God's power to transform. When I accepted and acted upon, and one of the messages this morning is acting, is hearing, receiving, and acting. Amen. So those five messages. One, a trumpet gives uncertain sound, preached 1963, January 14th. Second message, God hiding himself in simplicity. Why? Because the gospel is simple. God is hiding himself in simplicity, preached 1963, preached April 12th, 1963. And then hearing, receiving, and acting. Hallelujah. The gospel comes for you to hear, for you to receive, and for you to act. It was preached 1960, June 7th. And God's power to transform. Hallelujah! God's power to transform was preached, listen to this date, September 11th. Does that ring a bell? 9/11. God's power to transform was preached 9/11. 1965. Here the prophet is giving you and I a preview of the power of the word of God to transform. But devil also came and transformed United States. September 11th, the same date. Hallelujah. Devil came to the United States and transformed it. September 11th. The city of New York was transformed. The landmark of the city was transformed. The Twin Towers were transformed. They killed almost 3,000 people in one day. God said, I have the power to transform. Devil said, I can transform too. Hallelujah. Remember, when a trumpet blows an uncertain sound, who can it be compared to go to war? So if the gospel is blowing uncertain sound, then it will bring confusion. And today we are talking about the effect of the gospel. It turns out that throughout the ages, hallelujah, God in some good time had a mind of what he plans to do. That before God will do it, he has to speak. And the voice of God came as a trumpet. And when he thundered, it is God speaking. And if that trumpet sound and its uncertain sound, then everyone will be confused. For the trumpet compels Israel to war. So when Israel hears a trumpet, they know exactly what they must have to do. And I told you on Friday, which you know to be truth, that the gospel is a good news. The gospel is a good news. So if the news is good, but you're not able to hear the news, it does not change the quality of that news. It's just your problem not able to hear it. As I was talking here on Friday, I said to you, you might be on the internet, and you want to tune in to listen to what we're preaching here, like we have Sister Veronica on the internet. Perhaps, maybe Sister Veronica is not able to connect very well. Perhaps, maybe her internet is very slow. Perhaps you will not hear everything I'm saying. It turns out on Friday, when I came home, my nephew here, Brother Dennis, said to me, he was was not able to connect on Friday on the internet. I said, that's exactly what I'm saying. Does that mean I didn't preach on Friday? Did I not preach on Friday? Did I preach on Friday? Amen. Yes, I preached on Friday. That's right. But he was not able to connect. But I still preached. And so is the gospel. The gospel is a good news. To someone, they might not be able to hear it. To some, they will hear, they will not understand. But the news is still good. And the prophet said, every revival will produce a twin. Hallelujah. Every revival produces a twin. As it was written in the book of Romans, God said, even before the baby was formed in the womb, he said, Esau I hate, but Jacob I love. And that was a scripture that the prophet used to preach one of the messages this morning. Hallelujah. Esau I hate, but Jacob I love was used to preach the message, hearing, receiving, and acting. Romans 9, 11 to 13. Hearing, receiving, and acting. Hallelujah. See, the gospel is a good news, but if you're not tuned to the channel to hear the trumpet, which is the voice of God speaking, then you will not catch that news. Perhaps you will ask people, what is the news? And when you start asking them, what is the news, they can tell you what they are under to the news to mean, because you're not hearing from the source. You get what I call distorted news. Distorted news. Because you're not hearing from the source. That was the story of Eve. Eve did not hear from the source. Eve was hearing from Satan. Because Adam came straight from God. But Eve was a byproduct. And because she was a byproduct, she thought she knew what God said. And so when Satan came to her, it was easy for her to pick the wrong news. But the news is Adam, the day you eat this thereof, that day you must surely die. But then Satan came and said, you will not surely die. You will become so wise, just like God. It became another news. So Eve had another news from the news that God gave. And today there are so many news out there. There's political news, there's economic news, there's bacteria news, there's thyroid news, there's news everywhere. Where, what is standing today? What is certain today? What can you say is certain today? Is it the economy of man? Is it this world? Is it the world politics? Everything is shaking. The prophet told you to watch this China. He told you to watch this communism. He said, watch them. Watch Russia. Watch communism. What are they doing today? Nobody knew where this virus came from, but we knew where it started. Scientists, I am too, we tell you, we know the first place where it started. Why did it start there? They can tell us anything they want to tell us, but we know where it started. And it has crumbled the world economy. Why? Well, you have a politician in America that said it is America first. And so they told him, well, you think it's going to be America first? We are going to bring down the economy of America. What has happened now? There's war of virus all over the place, and every man's heart is shaking. What is shaking in this world? Where can you put your trust? Hallelujah! There is no place to put your trust. Everything is shaking. Everything is uncertain. And that is the problem of this world. Hallelujah. I think the volume is too high, right? The volume is high? Is it the volume, my brother? Oh, okay. If the volume is high, my son can tweak here. Hallelujah. Are we together? Are we together? You just distracted me a little bit, but all is well. Amen. Are you happy? Are you happy here? Blessed be the name of the living God. Friends, we are talking about the gospel. We receive something that is special. You see, we're all born in sin. We have no hope. Hallelujah. But as it was written in the book of Micah, as we read on Friday, in Micah chapter 5, verse 2. Micah 5:2 declared unto us. He said, you, Bethlehem Ephraimite, you be the least among Judah, but out of you will come the Messiah. God is in simplicity. All of you become the Messiah. The gospel is in simplicity. But who can believe the gospel? Hallelujah. Who can believe this gospel? Unto whom is the arm of God revealed? Isaiah wrote, who can believe our report? The question this morning, who can believe the gospel? The gospel is so simple. It will confine the wise and reveal to babies. That is how God has given this gospel. He gave the gospel in such a way that the wise and the prudent are deceived. But revealed to babies, the gospel is a good news to them that can receive it. Hallelujah. It's so easy to miss the gospel because of the simplicity of the gospel. You will question the origin of the gospel. You will question the voice of the gospel. You will question even the effect of the gospel. Just like Miriam did, just like Aaron did. When they questioned Moses, God doesn't just talk to you. God talks to all of us. God loves everyone. Everyone is a children of God. We are going to heaven. Everyone is loved by God. Who told you that? Can you show me that in the Bible? That's what you're thinking. That's not what God said. Everyone is not a child of God. Everyone is not going to heaven. Every seed will bring a fruit according to its kind. That's the word of God. Therefore, if the gospel came to you and there's some God in you, he will change your mortal vessel. Hallelujah. He will transform you. That's God's power to transform. This earth was void. And when the Spirit of the Lord came upon this earth, it moved upon the face of the earth and it breathed upon it. In other words, just like a man will know his wife to produce a child, the Spirit of the Lord came upon the earth and knew this earth to begin to produce. Before then it was void, which means it has no value. Darkness was upon the sea. There was nothing in earth. Hallelujah. And the Spirit of the Lord came and moved. Why? Because there's something God put there. There was some seed that was there. God has created those seed. And when His Spirit came to move, those seed begin to germinate. Hallelujah. If there was no seed there, there will be nothing to germinate. And so, if God is not in me, when the Spirit of the Lord comes to me, I have nothing to show. If God is not in you, when the gospel came to you, you will reject the gospel. How many people are Christians on earth? How many population on earth are Christians? Go and figure that. How many population? Christians are not more than 1/3 of the population of the earth. The Muslims are more than Christians, don't you know? Hallelujah. Everyone is going to heaven. God loves everyone. Is that right? Is that right? So even among different religion, we are not the most. Then you come to the so-called Christians. How many denominations do you have? Thousands of them. Are they all right? They have no right. There has to be a right way. Hallelujah. There has to be something right. There has to be something wrong. And when you find something right, it's a treasure. You can build on it. You can invest in it. Hallelujah. You can invest in it. When the prophet was preaching the message on certain side, he said, everything is uncertain. Even investment of man. If man goes to make investment, and you know, after you make the investment, you're going to lose, you will not invest in that product. You will not invest. What do? You want to mitigate your loss. You want to mitigate your loss. What does that mean? You want to limit your loss. When you take the probability of you gaining, the probability is so high that you will not gain. You will not invest in it. You want a low probability of loss so you can invest. Even man tried to do that. What do you think God has done? God made sure that the gospel is so sound. And God sent his voice to make sure that when a man hears the true gospel, he will not be uncertain. You can recognize this is God. And so when you recognize it is God, what does that mean to you? Then you're concerned. Then you believe it. You go into action. Hallelujah. When the voice of God came to Noah recognized, this is God speaking to me. And Noah went into action. If Noah had said, well, I don't think this is God. God told Noah, build a half a wood. Use a gopher wood.
to build me an ark. If Noah did not recognize this is God, and Noah didn't build an ark, you will not see Noah written in the scripture today. But Noah recognized the voice that spoke to him, that this is God. And Noah took it serious. And Noah went according to every prescription. Hallelujah. He recognized the voice that spoke to him. When Elijah had the voice of God for his day, to go and tell Ahab that religion he's practicing with Jezebel will lead him to hell, Elijah recognized the voice that spoke to him, and he went into action. Hallelujah! When you, a blessed believer, when you have this message, and you realize this is God speaking, this is the voice of God for my day, this is the acceptable way of the Lord for today, you recognize that this is God speaking. He put you into action. That is the gospel came to you. And you want to receive the gospel into your heart. And when the gospel comes into your heart, then the gospel has some effect in your life. Hallelujah.
Blessed be the name of the living God. Hallelujah. The woman of Samaria, she was inspired. And I think you have to realize, friends, if you're not inspired, the word of God has no effect in you. If you are not inspired, the gospel has no effect in you. Why? Look at the message to the Laodicean church age. They are lukewarm. They are not inspired. They are lukewarm. And God said, I spew you out from my mouth. Revelation chapter 3. They are not inspired. And therefore, for you to receive the gospel, you must be inspired. You must be looking for it. There must be a hunger in your heart. Hallelujah. And David said, there's honey in the rock for you. Why is there honey in the rock for you? Prophet used that to give an example. He said, you know, as a shepherd, when the sheep is sick, there's something about the limestone. The limestone is used to heal the sheep when the sheep is sick. And so a good shepherd will carry a bag of honey. And when their sheep is sick, they'll take that honey and put it on a rock. And the rock has a limestone. And the sheep will go to lick this honey from the rock. So when the sheep is licking the honey, they're also getting the limestone in their system to heal them. This morning, my brother and sister, there is honey in the rock for you. That rock is Jesus Christ. When you lick that honey out of that rock, you get a dose of Jesus Christ in your life. Hallelujah! You get some Holy Ghost in your life. You get the full gospel effect in your life. There is honey in the rock for you and I this morning. If you're hungry and thirsty this morning, you run to that fountain of fire. Run to that rock of ages. Lick up that honey tonight. He will do you something effect in your life. He will have a positive effect in your life. He will change your being. Hallelujah. God is hiding himself in simplicity. In Isaiah 53 from 1 to 10. God is hiding himself in simplicity. But who can believe our report? Isaiah 53 from 1 to 10. Who had believed our report? You see now, when you see that report, it's the gospel. Who had believed the gospel? How can you believe the gospel? Unto whom is the arm of the Lord revealed? What is the arm of the Lord? The effect of the word of God. Unto whom is it revealed? By revelation. Jacob knew the value of the birthright. By revelation, Jacob had the truth that the birthright belongs to him. And that's why God said, why they were in the womb, Jacob and love Israel hate. By revelation, he wants that birthright. And as a child of the living God, by revelation, you want the holy effect of the gospel in your life. By revelation, you want to become the living word. By revelation, there's no fear for a believer. But who can believe our report? It is so simple. For he shall grow up before him as a tender plant, as a root out of the dry ground. He had no form of comeliness. See how simple he is? No form. When you see him, he has even no beauty that you can even desire him. But he is despised. He is rejected. A man of sorrow, acquainted with grief.
We hide even our senses even from him. When you see him, you want to hide. You don't want to be associated with him. Hallelujah. Does that ring a bell? When you see him, you want nothing to do with him. This message, some people have come here, they got prayed for, God answered their prayer, and they say, oh, William Graham, no, we don't want anything to do with him. I have brothers that used to call me and say, why do you always preach and mention William Graham? I said, I've never told you I worship William Graham. He never told me to worship him because that would be Antichrist. But that's the voice of God for my day. Not because I say so, it's because God said so. And God vindicated it. If you find another voice that's vindicated, come and sit down and show me. Just show me. Show me the scripture where that voice is identified. And show me the works of that voice that's identified in the scripture. Then you can sit down. I'm telling you that a year is not enough for me to play the tape for you to see when God is vindicating each meeting. You cannot sit down for 1 year and listen to the whole message and see God vindicating each meeting. Each meeting. I'm glad I'm a message believer. Friends, without this message, I am rotten. I mean nothing. If you don't have the effect of the message, which is the gospel in your life, friends, you're miserable. You can't find joy nowhere. There's no joy in your family. You hear what I say? There's no joy in your family. There's no joy even in your children. You hear me? Okay. You find out. To serve God, sometimes you have to be alone. There's no joy in your job. There's no joy in all these things you put your mind into. No joy, zero, nothing. They will all fail you. They will all fail you one day. You will notice that. One day you sit over and cry and say, Lord, I see what you mean. That's why God said, I'm a jealous God. He didn't say to hate your children. No, but he said, trust me. Love me first. Love me. Trust in me. Don't go trusting in your husband. Don't go trusting in your children. Don't go trusting in your child. Don't go trusting in your mother and your father. No. Trust in God. They will all fail you. One way or the other, you're going to be very ashamed. One day you say, I don't know who this person is. They pray that they never come to you. Our prayer is God. Make it manageable for us. Because once you've chosen this way, hallelujah! Why is it another way? It's so narrow. It's so narrow, you're going to be walking alone. You will not fit two people on this road. When you're walking, you're by yourself. The only person you have within you is the Lord Jesus Christ. Not papa, not mama, not brother, no sister, nobody, but Jesus Christ. When you trust in him, he said, I will lead you. I will lead you through the narrow way. Oh, David said, the Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. Hallelujah. Amen. He was despised, but we esteem him not. Surely, he had borne our grief. Only him. He carried our sorrow. Only him. We did esteem him stricken, smitten of God. He was afflicted. Oh, but he was wounded for our transgression, bruised for our iniquity, chastisement of our peace was upon him, and with his stripes we are all healed. Is there any sick person here this morning? Is there any sick person here this morning? You just claim your healing. Hallelujah! You just claim your healing and receive it and hold on to it. Whatever it might be, claim it and receive it and hold on to it. Don't let go. Don't let go. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have all turned every one of us our own way. And the Lord had laid on him the iniquity of us all. Oh, he was oppressed. He was afflicted. He opened not his mouth. He was brought as a lamb to the slaughter, as a sheep before its shepherd. And so he opened not his mouth. Oh, he was taken as a prisoner from judgment. And who shall declare his generation? He was cut off out of the land and delivered. For in his transgression of my people was even he stricken. Oh, and he made his grave the wicked and the rich in his death.
Joseph of Arimathea, the rich, took him body. Hallelujah. The rich, he had done no violence. He was no deceit in his mouth. But what? Yet it pleased the Lord. See, it was the plan of God. It was the gospel news. It was good news. It pleased the Lord to do this, to bruise him, to put him to grief. That's the good news. You see how contrary it is? You see, it's perplexing, you know? You can't understand it. It is like a complex for you to understand, but yet it's simple. Because see, it was no comeliness in him, but you shall see his seed. See now, he shall prolong his day, and the pleasure of the Lord shall prosper in his hand. Hallelujah. That's the gospel news. But it comes in simplicity. Hallelujah. God is handing himself in simplicity. Glory. Glory. In Matthew 11, from 26 to 28, 25 to 26. Oh, where God thank himself, Jesus Christ. Oh, hallelujah. Matthew 11, 25 to 26. At that time, Jesus now answered. He said, I thank thee, O Father. Oh, Lord of heaven and earth. Because thou hast hidden all these things. It was all hidden. The gospel hidden. The truth of the gospel hidden. It was all hidden. The simplicity is hidden. You hide all these things. From who? You hide it from the wise, from the prudent, from the educated, from the theologians. It's all hidden. Hallelujah. But it's revealed unto babies. Hallelujah. Are you a baby for Christ? I am a baby. I hope you're a baby. I am a baby in his presence. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Even so, Father, it pleased you. It seemed good to thy sight. It pleased God. God is in simplicity. Hallelujah. The gospel is a simple message. You are free. You are free from sin. I want you to think like the slaves for a second. Think about it.
Think like the slaves for a second. When the slaves were emancipated, when they were told that tomorrow
all of you will be free. You don't want to be a slave. Hallelujah. But imagine on the sword, every slave is free. I want you to think about the commotion in their houses. They will come back and say, honey, did you hear the news? Did you hear the news? What news? The news said, honey, tomorrow we'll be free. Tomorrow we can have a life. Tomorrow they will not tie a rope on my neck and drag me around. Tomorrow somebody can just come and take your wife in front of you. I use her because you're just a product. Tomorrow, they can just bring your children to a market square and the highest bidder can take them. Say, honey, do you realize tomorrow we are going to be free? We're going to have a family. We can move out from Mr. X's house and have our own house somewhere. We don't care where we live under the barn. We don't care what's there, it's our own. Tomorrow we're going to be free. The joy brings to the home. I have a God that taking care of me. I was not put alone. He was with me. When I was in form, he was his hand. When you were in form, he was him. Hallelujah. But before this earth was even made, he talked about me. He talked about you and the days you are going to spend on this earth. And this rugged earth and all the filth and all the trial and all the pain. He knew everything. But he said, one day I am coming down myself. But set you free, my son. And when I set you free, you're really free. Only if you can see it. Only if you can receive it. Only if you can accept it. That is the good news in your life this morning. Give the Lord a hand. Glorify the Lord, living God. Don't worry about yourself no more. Don't worry about your prayer. Don't worry about your pain. Don't worry about your sickness. Brother, God has said you are free. He said you are wounded for his transgression. He was wounded for your transgression. He was bruised for your iniquity. And the chastisement of my peace was upon him. By his stripes we were healed. He declared that we are free. Why then do you worry? Why do you let the devil preach worry to your life? Every trial that's in your life will bring glory to the name of the living God.
just accept it and receive it and act upon it. Whatsoever it might be, you might not understand. He never called me to understand. He called me to believe all things are possible. Why do you then worry? Why do you then care? He's watching over the sparrow. He's watching over your eye. His eyes upon the sparrow. He's watching over us. He promised to give me a prophet. He delivered his promise. And so I am here to take the word of the prophet and eat the word of the prophet and become the word myself. And that's all I know. How will it happen? I don't have to worry about it. You don't have to worry about it. You just look at the word that's given to you. That is the gospel. Take the good news. And so that day, when the morning time comes, the slaves will be one on top of the mountain. They're looking to see. They send one of the slaves on top of the mountain to see the rising of the sun. Because from the mountain, you can see the sun coming. And when that slave sees that sun coming, the slave begins to scream, "We are free! We are free! Thank God Almighty, we are free!" And any slave that refuses to take his freedom remains a slave forever. And this day, the gospel news have come to set your life free. You are free. You are free from the bondage of sin. You are free from the wickedness of man. You are free from the way you were born. You are free indeed. He declared me free. That's what I know. Are you free this morning? Are you free this morning? Blessed be that name. But you've got to hear it. You've got to receive it. You've got to act upon it. Romans 9, 11 to 13 is the scripture that was used to preach the message, hearing, receiving, and acting. Romans 9, 11 to 13. Hallelujah. For the children, being not born, they are not even any good or evil. But the purpose of God, according to election, might stand, not of works, but of the covenant. It was said unto her, the elder shall serve the younger. As it is written, Jacob, I loved. Have I loved? But Esau, have I hated? What shall we say there? Is there unrighteousness with God? God forbid. Hallelujah. See now, when Rebecca heard this word, Jacob, have I loved? Esau, I hated. She acted upon it. She knew it. That's why when Esau wanted to kill Jacob, she ran to Jacob. She said, Jacob, you got to run now. See now, she knew. When their father wanted to die and ask for a food and somebody to go to the wilderness and get a little sheep and as he desired to eat it as a last meal, Rebecca had it. Rebecca knew. So Rebecca went to Jacob, said, Jacob, come on. Take something, wear something, look like Esau, and go present to your father. Because Rebecca knew that Jacob is loved by God. The elder shall serve the younger. She knew. God has said that. She knew it. So she's acting upon what she heard. She didn't stay dormant. She heard the younger because she inquired why they're fighting. Said, for this reason, that she knew. She heard the voice of God. She acted upon it. And truly, Jacob became Israel, which you know. Hallelujah. It was a prophecy that was given, and she knew it, and she acted upon it. And everyone who has ever followed God, when you hear the voice of God, you understand this is God. When someone had a voice, someone was young to understand the voice. And Eli said to someone, when this voice speak again, say, speak for your servant is not to hear. And so someone recognized that is God. And when the voice said again, someone said, speak. I said, go tell Eli that tomorrow he'll be dead. Because his sons, Hophni and Phinehas, were taking shoe bread from the temple. And they were not reprimanded. Friends, that's why you must teach your children well. Don't worry if they're going to love you or not. Don't put your hand in anything that is sinful. No matter what you think you're going to get. God is a jealous God. Surely he's a just God. He's going to judge every living. But if you judge yourself today, you will not be judged. That's why pride. Hallelujah. Never you put your hand in anything that's devil and evil. For anybody's good. Whatever is good that you will do. Whatever is bad, eschew it. Run away from it. When you see evil, speak. Don't stay dormant. Speak. Don't say it concerns me not. Speak. Don't be a politician. Speak. Hallelujah. If man will hate you, so be it. But God will love you. Hallelujah. If God be on my side, who can be against me? No one. So they can carry on with your hatred. But return that hatred with good. In everything, somebody don't return good. Return good. Hallelujah. If they slap you on the cheek, turn the other one. Hallelujah. When they hate you, return hate with love. Hallelujah. For when you return love with love, when you return love with hate, more love is given to you. It's grace upon grace. It's love upon love. Hallelujah. And so whatever you do, I will prosper because you are a child of God. Because the effect of the gospel is in your life. Hallelujah. Because you are walking gospel. Oh my God. Blessed be the name of the living God. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. God's power to transform. Oh, hallelujah. In Romans 12, 1 to 2. See now, once the gospel has come to you, and you have heard the voice of the gospel, you identified yourself as the voice. But no matter how simple it is, you've taken that simplicity. You heard it, you receive it, you're acting. You can go on and talk about many men in the scripture, many women in the scripture that knew that this is the voice of God. They acted on it. Everyone that came to Jesus, they recognized who he is. They acted on it. The woman with the issue of blood recognized that's Messiah. She acted on it. You can go on. Blind Bartimaeus recognized and acted on it. All of them have to act on it. Hallelujah. When you recognize that Jesus, you act on it. And when you act on it, we ask you, what do you want me to do for you? God is still walking the same way today. If you recognize the voice that's speaking to you, it's the message of the hour. Then you act on it. Hallelujah. And when you act on it, you receive the same blessing that the message was given. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Believe it, God. Do you believe it? Do you believe it? Say amen. Say amen. Blessed be the name of living God. When you believe that this is God, then you act on it. And when you act on it, you get the blessing that God promised to be on it. Why don't we receive it? Because we don't believe. Unbelief is why we're not receiving. The prophet said, when you pray for something and God hasn't given it to you, go back and say, God, why are you not giving me what I pray for? What more do you want me to do? Hallelujah. You ought to make sure you've done everything right. And then you come back again. Because the same way God healed every sick, if you come the same way the prophet said, he will heal you too. So if it has not happened, keep on praying. Keep on asking. Don't stop. Like the woman that came to the wicked church, she never stopped. And every morning she will come and plead her case. She plead her case. But this wicked just said, this woman is vexing me. What do you want from me? Hallelujah. That's how I go to God. That's how I call on his name. I don't plead on anything I want for him. I keep calling and crying and crying. That's God providing way. He said, God provided a way to save someone today. The prophet said, he said, God provided a way to save someone today. God provided a way for the animals. He brought it away from the tree, that the tree can shake and leave during the winter time and pick up again during the summer time. It's God providing way. When a little child wants something from their child, when my mother cry, that's God providing way. When I want something from my God, I get on my knees sincerely. I cry out the answer my call. Is that the way you pursue him? Have you received the message that way in your heart? Is the gospel burning in your heart? You're looking to do something for him? Hallelujah. Friends, we haven't gotten much hour to do these things. We haven't gotten too much time to do this thing. It is only now that's given to you. So each day ask yourself, Lord, am I anything for you? Don't just ask like Nathaniel asked, shall anything good come out of Nazareth? Today the question is, shall anything good come out of you? Me? That's the question this morning. Shall anything good come out of me? Nathaniel asked, shall anything good come out of Nazareth? No. This morning is, shall anything good come out of me or you? That's the essence of the gospel. Now look at it in this message. God's power to transform. Romans 12, 1 to 2. Shall anything good come out of me
I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercy of God, present your body a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God. That is your reasonable service. And be not conformed to this world. Be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. Shall anything good come out of me? Do you have any service that's acceptable to the Lord? Are you a living tabernacle acceptable to the Lord? That's the question that you just said, go back to verse 1. Present yourself a living sacrifice, yourself, myself. Hallelujah! Hallelujah! It's not just shall anything good come out of Nazareth. Shall anything good come out of me and you? Can you present yourself like a living sacrifice? Holy, acceptable? Do you ask yourself that question, Lord, am I acceptable unto you? Have you heard the gospel? Has the gospel transformed you to become a living tabernacle unto him? Hallelujah! Hallelujah! Are you in line to do that? Then have you accepted his provided way? Hallelujah! Have you accepted his provided way? Have you accepted God's provided way today? Have you accepted his way? When you accept God's provided way at this end time, hallelujah, is that your portion now? Have you accepted it? Are you sure you have? Hallelujah. Blessed be the name of the living God. And Jesus said, he said, I will draw all men towards me. Hallelujah. I will draw all men towards me if I be lifted up. That's the word of the Lord. And that's God's provided way, to draw all men towards himself. That's what he's looking for. Are you part of that all men that he's drawing to himself? If I be lifted up, I will draw all men towards me. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Do you love the Lord? I want to give you that scripture, because that's the final scripture here. Then we read some of the messages. Time pressing us. Amen. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. If I be lifted up, I will draw all men towards me. Thank you, Lord. It's right here. I said Matthew, but I have it here, the message. Okay. It's two scriptures I want there. Genesis 22. And then we're going to read, if I be lifted up, it's John 12, 32. But Genesis 22, from verse 7. This is for the message. Accepting God's provided way at the end time. Not just at any time, at the end time. Amen? Right. Amen? Isaac spoke unto Abraham, his father, and said, my father. He said, here I am, my son. He said, behold the fire, behold the wood, but where is the lamb for burnt offering? And Abraham said, my son, God will provide himself a lamb for burnt offering. So they went both of them together. Amen. Let's go to John 12, 32. God is providing a way. In John 12, 32, Jesus said, and if I be lifted up from this earth, I will draw all men unto me. This is the essence of the gospel. Jesus Christ is lifted up. The gospel that Jesus Christ came afresh. And he was lifted up that day at Calvary. And he rose on the Easter morning to draw all men towards him. And God's provided way has always been that way. It's a way of the blood for the gospel. There's no other way.
that for every age, God has made a way for his children. And at this end time, he made a way by providing a prophet that's vindicated. Hallelujah! And when this message was being preached, Brother Abraham said unto them, you know, you could say to me, he said, God made a way in the past. God brought a way in the past, but today he said, I will prove to you that God has brought a way again today. Hallelujah! Hallelujah! And he said unto them, all that are sick, all that are sick, he said, put your hand on one another and begin to pray. And the glory of the living God came into the place. And the sick were healed. And the hungry were disarmed. He said, this is what Jesus Christ did that day. When he saw the woman of Samaria, when the Samaritan woman saw him, he disarmed her heart. And as he was on that day, when the Son of Man is being revealed, so shall it be this day. Hallelujah. It was a vindication of the message of the hour. So you need no argument, for the gospel comes not just in words, but in demonstration of the Spirit. And the same Spirit is here this morning. Why? Because I believe the message, and you believe the message, and you are acting on the message. And when you believe and act, you become the effect of the gospel, and you are controlling the things of this world, and devil has nothing to do with you. Devil can just bluff at you. Hallelujah! But I have no fear, and you should have zero fear. Why? If this earthly tabernacle be destroyed, we have one already waiting for us. Hallelujah! If this earthly tabernacle be destroyed, we have one waiting for us. What devil has on humanity has always been death. Is that right? All the prophets of old, they die. And one day, as a king of glory, he came down from glory. He walked down on this earth. And when devil saw him, he said, I'm going to deal with him once and for all. And so on that day, he was staggering like he has no strength. Why? Like Isaiah has written, he was smitten, but he pleased God. He opened up not his mouth. So when devil saw him, devil said, surely he's not God. Look how weak he is. I'm just going to deal with him. I'm going to kill him like I killed each and every one of them. Hallelujah! 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 On that day at Calvary, when he slayed there, he stretched forth his hand because they nailed him at a cross. And at that 11th hour, the devil said, this is it. And devil came with death. But there's a mistake devil made that day. Hallelujah. Devil made a mistake that day. You know, when a bee comes to sting you now, the bee has got to sustain. And if the bee sting you and sting deep, it will lose that sting. So it will not sting again. If it stings deep. So it doesn't sting deep. It stings you a little bit and still go with the sting. So it can sting somebody else. But when it came to Jesus, he made such a mistake. He stinking so deep that he lost his sting. So when he lost it now, that's why Apostle Paul, when his time came, he looked at devil. He said, death, where is your sting? Because he lost his sting when he stabbed Jesus. Hallelujah! So he has no sting no more. He said, your sting is taken away. Grace, where is your power? You're powerless now because you took the King of glory and he went down to death. He went down to the grave. He took the key of death and he took the hallelujah and he set the captives free and he declared that death have delivered in him. Death shall never die. That is the gospel in fact. I shall never die. You shall never die. The sting of death is removed. There's no more condemnation to them that believe in the Lord and in God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Oh, blessed be the name of the living God. Oh, blessed be his name. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Let's take some words for the prophet. As many as we can. I have them all over the place. Oh, my God. Let's start with one. A trumpet blowing a sudden sound, pitch 18 by 142.
things are marked all over the place. See how much you can bring. If you can find it, you can go for a sister. Top page 107, 1963, January 14. I'm going to read page 18 by 142. Line 142, page 18, prophecy said, there's only one church you can belong to. You never join it. You might join the lodge, Methodist lodge, Presbyterian lodge, Baptist lodge, Pentecostal lodge, but you're born into the church of Jesus Christ. So, that's the church. Those are lodges where people come together like crows. See now, they sit on their limbs and doors on their limbs and so forth. That's your fellowship you have together. But when you're sharing on the same time, but when it comes to the church of Jesus Christ, there's only one. What are they doing? That's birth. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Now, I'm skipping because I have to skip. Page 148. Page 19, line 148. Now, and the church of the living God doesn't inject this to try to make themselves look like something. They are already what they are by the grace of God. The word of God is joined with them, and they are joined with the word. And the works that was brought forth in that perfect one, Jesus Christ, God manifested in flesh, will produce itself through every born again believer. He said so. Amen. Nothing else. Now, that's something certain. It is certain. Amen. Amen. Let's say in the name of the living God. Page 20, line 160. Now, the whole Christian army hears the trumpet. God said, that was the trumpet. He cannot change it. That's the sound that he said was sung by. This will all men know, and away goes the church. Some of them don't believe in his literal coming. The Bible said he will come, so we are looking for his coming. If he isn't here tonight, we'll be looking in the morning. If he isn't here in the morning, we'll be looking tomorrow. And we'll keep on looking. If we fall asleep or wasn't fainted in vain, for the trumpet of God shall sound, and the final trumpet, and the dead in Christ shall rise. And we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with him, with them to meet the Lord in the air, and forever in them. That is the sound of the trumpet. Whether I live or whether I am gone, don't make any difference. I will hear the sound. I will rise. Glory to God. Rise. Oh, yes. Yes. Amen. Amen. You love the prophet? I love him. Amen. On page 28, line 223. On page 28, line 223. Let me sum up, said the prophet, in saying this. Brother, sister, for the next few minutes, I believe it. I believe that everything else, everything that's contrary to that, is not right.
Amen.
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 Amen. Okay, it's better. I believe that, I believe that everything that's against that will fall. I believe it. I don't care how many communism or how many of these isms and that ism and churchism and Romanism and other Americanism now, see, Americanism. That, you hear that in politics today, America first, Americanism and everything else. They will all fall. But that word will stand eternally because it is a word. And before it was a word, it was to be a thought.
And the word is a thought express. And God in eternity, it comes into his mind, he expresses his thought, it becomes a word, and the word has to be made manifest. That's the reason when he spoke of a Messiah, and there had to come a Messiah. He spoke that there will be a church in the last day, without spot, without wrinkle, and there will be a church. There, hallelujah, he said it. I take his word, I believe it. Hallelujah. I believe that he promised the Holy Ghost to every believer that will believe. I believe Peter on the day of Pentecost, when he preached that notable sermon and told them all to repent and be baptized, that this sign shall come, and this, and whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord will be saved. I believe that it is the truth. Stood on it. I've seen it manifested. Hallelujah. Blessed be the name of the living God. I've seen it manifested. Have you seen it manifested in your life? Have you? Oh, blessed be his holy name. And the message God had himself in simplicity. I have a couple of lines there. Page 9, line 57. That's 1963, March, April 12th. Page 9, line 57. Oh, you know, God is so great. He hides himself in simplicity. And then he reveals himself in his own thing. He hides himself in. And God is so great. He can make himself simple. That's what makes him great. So many miss him in the simplicity. Simple ways that he hides himself. Now, we know that man cannot do this. Man cannot make himself great enough to be simple. See? Oh, now what makes God so great is because he can be so simple. And God does not reveal himself in greatness, as we call greatness. Hallelujah! You see the simplicity? You see how he has himself? You see why he's God? Because he's so simple. Hallelujah. Oh my God. On page 10, 59, the prophet said, when we do anything, I can do something in this year, I think that is right. Next year, or maybe next week, I can, where I am wrong, I see where I'm wrong, but God cannot, because he's infinite. His first decision is he's ever called upon the sin, so to act the same way he acted to the same decision. That's the way he must act every time. That decision has to be made again, because if he did not, then he acts a certain way on this decision, and as a certain subject comes open again, and if he doesn't act that same way again, he did the same first time, then he acted wrong the first time. Therefore, if a man ever come to him for salvation and he saved him upon the basis he saved him upon, he has to save the next man upon the same basis. And if a man ever come to him for healing, hallelujah, and he healed that man upon a certain basis, if he, the next man, comes, he's got to heal him again the same basis. He cannot change it. He must ever be the same. Oh, God made a problem. When man sinned in the beginning, but he tried to find a way to escape for himself. He tried to make himself a covering, fig leaves, and so forth. It never worked. But God did make a way that man could fellowship with him again. And that was under the shed blood of an innocent substitute. And that's the only way that God ever did meet man. And that's the only way God ever can meet man, is under the shed blood of an innocent substitute. Hallelujah!
Praise God.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. My God. Oh. Line 65. In the beginning, when man sinned, he showed the nature of man. He's always trying to hide himself from God. God himself had a way that he can't feel justified in religion. That's been a religion, mean a covering. So he tried to make himself his own religion. But God made his decision
on how he would meet man. And that was upon the shepherd. That's the only way, no matter how much we try. Try it that way. That's the only way, the only place that God will ever meet man for fellowship is under the shepherd. God only meet Israel under the shepherd. The only place that Israel could worship was under the shepherd. And today, we have tried organization. We have tried denomination. We have tried education. We have tried scientific achievement. We have tried everything to try to bring man into a unity for fellowship. And that has failed. And every one of them, there's only one place that man can meet and fellowship with God. And the fellowship with each other. And that's under the cross. Hallelujah. And when each man accepts the blood of Jesus Christ, I don't care. Then all of this and peculiarity, and he can still reach over and put his hand in the next man's hand and call him brother. When we meet at that cross, hallelujah, where Jesus died. Hallelujah. Blessed be the name. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Any message, hearing, receiving, and acting. Page 6. Hallelujah. Hearing, receiving, and acting. Page 6. Line 15. Man, sometimes it means you walk alone. If you really are sincere and you really receive the birthright, you don't care to walk alone. If the neighbors won't invite you anymore over to dinner, if nobody will have anything to do with you, what difference does it make to you? As long as you are that development, that's the main achievement of your life. You want to achieve something in life, friends, young ones? That's your achievement, development. Not your association with friends, nothing else. Bed right. Hallelujah. As long as you got the bed right, that's your greatest achievement in life. Hallelujah. As long as I am born of the Holy Spirit, with what difference does it make? As long as I am on my road to heaven, what difference does it make? What difference does it make? Hallelujah. Whether people, as long as we are walking in the Spirit, and all that are born of the Spirit of God are led by the Spirit of God. Sons and daughters of God are led by the Spirit of God. Always walking in the beautiful light of the holiness, cleanliness. But Esau, hallelujah, that birthright, he was carnal like the world. So it didn't even make any difference to him. He thought he had religion, you see. And his papa and his mama were religious, see. And that was good enough for him. So we find out that in every revival that's ever going to be born in the world, it produces twin. That's right. Every revival has twin. They have bunch in there that are carnal believers and bunch of spiritual believers. Every revival produces that. Esau and Jacob. Hallelujah. Which one are you? Which one are you? You can call him. Which one are you? I am Jacob. Which one are you? Jacob. Are you Jacob? Are you Jacob? Hallelujah. You better call it. Are you Jacob? Amen. I'm Jacob. Hallelujah. Accept it and I receive it. Hallelujah. I am not Esau. God forbid. Hallelujah. Blessed be the name of the living God. Yes, every revival will produce a twin. Hallelujah. And then continue here on page 10. See, his church means called out of the world. Not of the world anymore. Separate yourself from the things of the world. The Bible said, if you love this world and the things of this world, love of God is not even in you. No matter how good a church member that had nothing to do with it, although man should belong to a church and woman, we should also belong to church, children and all of us. We should all belong to church, but first we must be in the church of the firstborn. The born into the church of God. Now, we find out that this revelation comes and a man hears it. He recognizes it to be God and then he acts upon it. The carnal mind hears it and says foolishness and walk away from it. Now, could you
imagine way back in the Bible time when Noah was out in the field one day, and when a farmer, and he heard the voice of God. Voice of God said, there's going to be a rain. He's going to cover the face of the earth. I am going to destroy all the wickedness of this world. It has to come to that end. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. When the voice is clear unto you, you hear it, you receive it, and you act on it. Amen. Amen. You hear it, you receive it, you act on it.
Only one to read over there. Page 17.
On page 17, the prophet said this. Oh, if you could recognize it is God's promise. Go into the world and preach this gospel. These signs shall follow them that believe. No matter what the intellectual world will say, you don't associate with that. You heard, you recognize it was God's word because it's in the Bible. Then you act upon it. Oh, prophet gave a testimony here. He said, I remember my own father put me out of the house. I had my clothes in a paper bag, paper sack. He said, you can't act like that around here. I said, there's a whole big world out here to act like that. I took off. Sure, I had the Holy Ghost. Something burning in my heart. I have heard. I believe it. I receive it. Is that you this morning? I have heard. I believe it. I receive it. Amen. Let's say it together. I have heard. I have heard. I believe it. I receive it. Amen. Hallelujah. That was the word of my prophet. I receive it. I recognize it was God's promise. So, all I pour out my spirit, this sign shall follow them. The promise is unto you and your children. That was me, said Brother. That was me. I said that was me. Whoever will be, let him come. That was me. I wore great big thick glasses. My head shook all the time with asthmatism. I was only just a boy, right? But I believe divine healing. Why? I heard it. I recognize it. It was God's promise. I went on my own Baptist church. I said to the pastor, get some anointed oil. He asked the Baptist pastor, do you have some anointed oil? He said, what do you want with the oil, with the anointed oil? I said, I want to be anointed. He said, what for? I said, I'm sick. He said, what's the matter with you? I said, I can't, my eyes is bad. I can't hardly see. Take these glasses off. They have to lead me around our asthmatism. Oh, he said, really? I said, that's right. You ain't got anything, I'll bring you some. And I went down, I got some oil. He got the oil himself. I got some oil. Abraham got the oil himself. I prayed over it. And he came up. He handed it to him. He said, he anointed me with the oil like that. I said, hallelujah. Hallelujah. Amen. Here I went. That was it. Doctor said, if I eat one mouthful of solid food, it will kill me. This is Abraham. He can't eat solid food. If I eat one mouthful, he will die. Said, because my stomach had nothing but one big bloody ulcer. This is Abraham. One big bloody ulcer. And I went home, and I Pop was sitting there, and Pop was sitting there, which is father, and we had cornmeal, cornbread, and beans. And you know how poor people live now? They are poor. And I said, well, we never had a blessing asked at the table, which is to say when they come to eat, they don't pray even on the table. That's what Abraham. They don't even pray on the table. Are you getting it? You see how far God brought him? You see how far the gospel brought him? Hallelujah. If the gospel can bring my prophet this way, what about me and you? See now, they don't pray even to eat. He said, they don't pray. And it was strange. So now the Abraham said that day, this party said, will you all bow your head just for a minute? And I know dad looked at me, and mother looked like strange. I said, God, I don't know how to pray, but somehow or another, I believe you. I believe that you healed me. I've been anointed, and I'm taking your word. Now, Mama, set me out some barley water and prune juice. And that's all I have. I've been eating that and Graham crackers for about a year. 1 year, that's what he eats. Because he can't digest nothing for a year. And Mother said, you're not. What's you going to eat? I said, some beans and some cornbread. Give me a piece of that onions too. So these are the things you don't eat when you have ulcer. You'll die right away. So give me some onions too. And why she had thought I lost my mind. So she called up the doctor. Doctor said, it will kill him just as soon as that goes into his stomach. I said, it will kill him. It will give him acute indigestion and he will die. I said, this doctor said that, but I have heard, and I believe, I have received, and I'm going to act on what I believe. Hallelujah! Hallelujah! I have heard, and I believe, and I'm going to act on what I have believed. Hallelujah! That's right, I heard it. I recognize this to be the word of God. This Bible, hallelujah, it came out of the Bible. The prayer of the faith shall save the sick. And the Father, anything in my name, I will do it. And that was all he said. I recognized it. That was God's word. It was God speaking to me. So I went into the action. Oh my, what took place? Sure, that was what Elijah done. That was what Moses done. That was what Noah has done. Hallelujah. That was what John the Baptist had done. This is a testimony of Brother Abraham. This testimony means from that day, he began to eat whatever he wanted to eat. His eyesight was restored back. Hallelujah. Because he trusted the word of the living God. It was a simple word. He was not even acting as a prophet then. He did not even pray and did a table there. But he believed the word and he manifested the word. What would the word of God do to a believer who take the word of God serious in your heart? Don't doubt the word of God, hallelujah. Whatever comes your way, remember, the word of God can never come back for it. God will never be defeated. Never. Never. Hallelujah. Can never be defeated. We are coming down. We're almost done. God's power to transform. I have to finish it. Give me a few more minutes here. God's power to transform. That's September 11, 1965. Line 37, page 5. Now, this word transform. I looked it up in the dictionary, said the prophet, when I almost lost track of my time and I was told to be here, he said, when I was looking for the text, I found this word of the text, rather scripture, to describe it says that something has changed. Transform, something has changed. It has changed, has transformed, made different than what it was. See, that's what the gospel light does. It transforms, it changes, hallelujah. It illuminates, hallelujah. You begin to shine, hallelujah. When your friend sees you, you're no longer who you used to be, hallelujah. Your sisters, your friends, your brothers, when they look at you, something has changed. They say you have changed, you're not who you used to be. What happened to you? Tell them it's the gospel light. Hallelujah! Hallelujah! The young girls that are here, when another young girl sees you, you don't look like them, you don't dress like them, you don't talk like them, because you have changed. Something has changed in you. Hallelujah! The young boys that are here, when some little boy sees you, they want to behave certain way. You can't behave that way because you have changed. Something has touched your life. The gospel light has shined on you. You are now having the effect of the gospel. You are transformed. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Oh my God. On page 6, lines 38.
On verses 9:38, and I thank him this morning in Genesis, this world was without form. It was void, and darkness was upon the earth. Nothing but a complete chaos. And when this world was in this condition, the Spirit of God moved upon the face of the water, and the entire picture was changed from total chaos to a garden of Eden. That is transformation, power of God. That God can take something that is nothing and make something wonderful out of it. That is transforming power. And we understand that by reading the scripture, that God in 6,000 years making this preparation for Eden. Now he might not have been that long, but just presuming that it was taken that from the scripture where it is said, one day with your God is like 1,000 years. Hallelujah, I'm of God. And that should count time and then say that it was 6,000 years he had in his making of this earth, and he had planted upon the earth all the good seed. There were just everything was made perfect. So it took God about 6,000 years. Oh, and everything was made perfect for his son Adam, only for him to lose it. But he said, I will restore. Hallelujah! Hallelujah! Let's read down. I just have a few more here. Few more here. Page 9, verse 63. Where the seventh morning, when God looked upon all everything and said, I am pleased with it. Yeah, I am glad I did it. And it's all now under control. And I have put trust in my son and his wife that they will help all of them now. They will watch over all of them now. You see, it is right that everything will bring forth of its kind. Now, he has the power to do that. See, God then said, well, if it's all so good, I can't be anything else because it is my own desire. It is the way that I want it. And I have spoken it that way. And my word has brought it just exactly the way I wanted it. And there it is. It's all good. So the Bible says, God rested the seventh day from all his work, and everything under control to bring forth all the kind. Now remember, to bring, when he put the seed in the earth, the seed can only come forth with the power of the that was life within it. See now, to transform it. So the seed has to be on the earth so that there's power to transform it. That's why I said unto you, if you don't have God in you, when the gospel comes to you, you cannot receive it, because there's nothing in you to receive it. My God, from that seed of the plant or whatever it was, he's transforming power now. So God put the seed in there with the potential that it will now be what he said it will be. See now, the seed has a potential. So you are a seed, you have the potential. And when the gospel strikes you, now your potential becomes manifest. Hallelujah. It's like when two omnipotent meet. God is omnipotent. When he meets his child, his children are becoming omnipotent because they have the power to create. I don't have the power. I don't have the control of all the earth. I don't was amateur God. I don't was a mini God. I am a mini God. You are a mini God. You have the power to transform. You have the power to create. But when I created this world, and the pride has the same power, when the pride recognizes who they are, the power to transform. Blessed be the name of the living God. We don't receive because we don't believe. We believe shallow. We don't believe shallow. We don't believe deep. We don't sink deep into belief. We don't believe with all our heart. We believe with our lips, our eyes, and our heart is empty. If we can receive the word of God in our heart, my friends, there's nothing impossible for God to do. Because the word of God cannot lie. What do you need this morning? Hallelujah. What's your desire this morning? Hallelujah. Receive it down your heart. Hallelujah. Receive it down to your heart. Hallelujah. Let the word of God sink deep onto your heart. Hallelujah. Determine today to go all the way for the Lord and watch him go all the way for you. Hallelujah. Total sellout. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Page 10, 970. The deformer, I know this to be rather strange to speak of this way, to deform. But that's what he was. He was a deformer. Perverted, that's devil. Perverted means to change over. You see? Like I told you, September 11, he deformed the United States. He's a deformer.
See? The message was preached September 11, 1965. God about to transform. And on September 11, about 2000 or so, the day that it happened, and September 11, he was in 2011, right? 2001, right? 2001, that's New York. September 11, 2001, World Trade Center. Therefore, the former did this. And the prophet is talking about him here. He said, the former, to change over, to make something different. To the form is the same thing. It's been brought over, and the form are made in another way. Yet it is still the same seed. It's a deforming seed. Now we found this deformer has always been same amount of time to deform as God had to transform. So now he planted his seed and never planted his own seed in the Garden of Eden. Since that time, he had 6,000 years of deforming the seed of God. Deforming it. So he has 6,000 years to change the same news you have of the gospel, being a good news, to become a bad news. He deformed the gospel from a good news to a bad news. And people now say they don't believe in God. People don't believe in Jesus Christ. People don't want to go to church no more. They look at some of the behaviors of the churches. They say, I want nothing to do with them. He deformed the very good news you have. And that was what the good news that was declared by Peter on the birthday of Pentecost. That's why God had to send a prophet to manifest the real gospel. To give you the real voice of God. Not just a voice. He deformed the gospel by this denomination, by this big cathedral, by this big position, by the works of men. They made the work of God of no effect. And some people want no more gospel, good news. But grace be to God, he sent me a prophet to declare that the days of miracles are not over. He sent me a prophet to tell me I am a child of God. He sent me a prophet to tell me this world got nothing against me and you. If you believe it, you are not the product of this world. He has passed it through. Hallelujah. Devil has 6,000 years to deform the very gospel that we have received. Take a look at the world today. They said to him, if God be on our side, how can God allow this thing to happen? How can God allow coronavirus to happen? If God be on our side, is it not the same question Gideon asked? When Gideon was there with the Midianites, did Gideon not ask the same question? When the angel of the Lord came to Gideon, if God be on our side, how come the Midianites are killing us? That's the same thing today. That's why God has to send a prophet, not just a prophet, but the voice of God for the last day. And if you know that's the voice of God, you take it serious. If somebody comes to you and tells you the days of miracle, then I am a miracle. Are you looking for a miracle? I am a miracle. Hallelujah! I am a miracle. If they said to you, the days of miracle, I must have a miracle. You're looking at a miracle. What more do you want to see? But life is a miracle. Hallelujah! I am not alone because he promised to be with me. Therefore, I am a miracle. He says, surely the world will see me no more. But I'm going to see him because he's in me. Therefore, I am a miracle. Blessed be the name of the living God. Are you looking for a miracle? I am a miracle. You are a miracle. That you bring this message to a miracle. That you can sit down here without going to work to make so much money. It's a miracle. That this person has arrested you. It's a miracle. This person has humbled you. It's a miracle. Blessed be the name of the living God. Thank you, Jesus. Just defeat devil at every corner. It's a lying vagabond to tell us the days of miracle are over. Tell us we are alone. Tell us we are defeated. It's a lying vanity. It's a deformer. Hallelujah! Not this bride. We have gone too far. Soon and very soon, we are going to see the Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. In ending, we're going to end with accepting God's provided way. Has a couple of verses there to end the service. Accepting God's provided way. I'm going to read about two or three lines there. 1963, January 15. Start with page 31. Page 31, line 238. In closing, hallelujah, hallelujah. The world needed a savior one day, and God provided his son. When he came, he was not recognized. He was not wanted. They said they wanted a savior. But when God sent it in his own way, they asked for a king. God gave them a baby. They wanted a mighty man,
to storm our room, God gave them a little crying baby in a bar. See, but it was God's provided way. But they didn't want it that way. God wanted it to send it to them. They wanted it the way they wanted it. See, so therefore, they went into chaos because they didn't accept his way. There was some that did. This was the birthplace of the church. That was Pentecost. After Jesus had commissioned them, go into the world, preach the gospel to every creature. This sign shall follow them that believe. He had told them what to do. Told them to go up into the city of Jerusalem and wait. They needed a charter. They needed a charter. They wanted to draw up a creed. God gave them the Holy Ghost. Oh, they needed a denomination, but God gave them Spirit. What a difference. How God does it. The Holy Ghost was God's. Hallelujah. Provided way to lead the church. Not a bishop. The Holy Ghost, that's what was their charter. And from that day to this day, it has been every true born again child charter. The Holy Ghost. After 2,000 years, my friends, we are closing now. If you want to be on your feet, if you are tired, be on your feet. After 2,000 years, my friends, oh, man has determined to have his own way. He made himself a charter. He made himself a man-made ethics. Oh, what did he do? Yeah, it was because by this great falling away from the truth, they got off. The people don't know what to do. Creed and denomination, all kinds of isms, scientific sensation, and everyone says, the Bible said this, but they will take this part of it, but they won't take this part of it. They don't follow the chapter here, therefore they lose this cause. And after all these years, when we got 900 and something different organization of Christianity, and each one of them is condemning the other, they are saying this is right, they are saying this is wrong, and this is right, and this is wrong, and so forth. And the poor people are so confused, they don't even know what is right and what is wrong. What to do? What do we do? What do we need? We need to get back to the cause. Get back to the charter. What do we need? We need a genuine true scripture, signs of the truth, a vindicated gospel truth, in that the church needs to be at this end time. Hallelujah. God promised to give them a sign for this last day. Do you remember when Jesus Christ was speaking? The pain of Shiva shall rise up on the last day, will rise up and condemn that generation. Oh, she came from the uttermost part of the world to hear the wisdom of Solomon. They had a spirit of discernment. How she could suffer. So to see the spirit of discernment, he said, greater than Solomon is here. Hallelujah. 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 Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Oh my God. Thank you, Lord. Page 35. Page 35. Just a little quote there. Line 262. Brother Abraham said this. Brother Abraham said, God's provided way that he might do what? Let's say this together. Bring it. Line 262. God's provided way that he might bring. God's provided way that he might bring. You can find it. Okay. God's provided way that he might bring the believers to a rapture in faith. Hallelujah. Let's say it. God's provided way that he might bring the believers to a rapturing faith. God's way. He's provided way to bring believers to rapturing faith. Hallelujah. This is the gospel. God's provided way for this end time is to bring the believers faith of rapture. So if somebody says to you, why do you believe the message of Abraham? It's not because he's a handsome man. No. It's not just because he was born poor. No. It's because he came to give me the right to have rapture in faith. And
fire of your children's faith when they are the rapture. Keep watching. Hallelujah. If they want to doubt, you say, keep watching. Keep watching. But Brian gave an example. He said, I believe in London, one of the ministers in London was trying to pass by, and one person was blocking him or something. Then he said to him, can I pass by? He said, no, I don't give way to fools to pass by. So the minister said, I do. Did you catch it? Did you catch it? So one person is coming this way. He said, can I pass by? He said, no, I don't give way to fools to pass by. He said, well, I do. So he walked past. So who is a fool now? See, he gives way to fools to pass. See? You see now? So if somebody is doubting, whatever I believe is true, just keep watching. Keep watching. One day, you see me go. Just like Elijah went. It will be too late then. Because I know I'm going. I know I'm going. Hallelujah! How do I know? Because I know. Hallelujah! I know what I believe. How do you know? Because you know. Hallelujah! You know it. Hallelujah! You know the way. Jesus said, you know the way. It has been shown to you. Hallelujah! Hallelujah! See now, so let's go to page 37. We are rounding up. Page 37, line 281 to 284, the prophet said here, I have been reluctant. He didn't want to say this. He said, I have been reluctant on these things. The 15, 16 years I have been on the field. But there's an hour coming now when something is fixing to take place. The message will go to another nation. Friends, pay attention. Every kid, don't run. Every kid, close your mouth. Every child, please be quiet. We are closing here. Amen? I have been reluctant to say these things. I have been on the field. But yes, an hour coming now when something is fixing to take place. The message will go to another nation, another people. But while we are in the presence of the Holy Spirit, the church in America, I believe, is just about called out. About. Are you hearing it? The church in America is just about called out. About called out. She's finished. She's washed. She's ready. The real church. Hypocrisy will remain on. But a true church to begin with, but again, predestinated to the call of God. If you believe with all your heart, I ask you to pray and say, Lord Jesus, in your heart, let me touch your garment. And how will I know that you are still the same high priest? Speak to me through the lips of Brother Branham. And if he has told me the truth, which I believe he has, be sure to mention that in your prayer. Because he told me, if you get the people to believe you, that's the only. He couldn't do many mighty works because they didn't believe him. Don't believe me as I am him. Don't believe me as him. Did you get that? For people who want to worship Abraham, he said, don't believe me as him. He never told you he's him. He said, believe him. They believe the voice that's speaking to you about him. But Abraham said, don't believe me as him. But believe that he sent me, and I am here to manifest him. He proved that he was. May God help me to prove that he is risen from the dead. The Messiah said yesterday, today, and forever. Now, just in prayer, may we be on our feet, please. May everybody be on their feet, please. Please, may we be on our feet. It's a word of prayer from the prophet to us.
said, just pray. And if the Lord will grant it, we'll prove to you that this is the end time sign. Will you walk in the light? Will you believe him? Will you have faith in him? He is no respecter of a person. Just have faith. All along, everywhere. Now, while your heads are bowed, I'm thanking the Lord. Amen? Amen? May we begin to thank the Lord. Now, Brother Abraham said, now, do this. Can everyone come, please? People in the room, come. Bring the kids. Come, let's pray. Everybody come here, please. Everyone in that room, please come over. Now, put your hand on each other. Let's do what the prophet said here. He said, now, put your hand on one another. Find somebody to put your hand on, please. Leave the key to run away. Run around. Don't worry about it. I'm okay with her. Put your hand on somebody. Say, put your hand on one another. It is going to pray for each other now. If you are a sinner, confess your sin. If you are a backslider, confess your wrong. If you are sick, confess that you want to be healed. And say, I believe you, God. Now, the Bible never say, just the prayer of William Graham will do this. But he said, those signs shall follow them that believe. If they lay their hands on the sick, they shall recover. Do you believe that? Say, amen. Now, how many times, how long have I been with you? Phoenix, said the prophet, this is your 17th year. I have been coming here. Have you ever seen it prove wrong one time? Has it ever been just exactly the same way the Holy Spirit spoke it? Though the thousands of times and thousands and thousands and multitudes of times, how many times around the world, all the nations and kingdoms and tongues and people, is Jesus Christ not your brother? And I am putting his word to you, this sign shall follow them that believe. If they lay hands on the sick, they shall recover. Now lay your hands on somebody and pray for them. Don't you pray for yourself now, because they are praying for you. You just pray for them. And now let's bow down our heads. Let's bow down our heads in the almost presence of the risen Christ, and who proves himself to be among us. Now he's your God. He's the same as he was, my God. Now you pray the way you do in your churches. Now pray for that person that's got their hand on you. You just pray back to them and believe on God. Confess your sin. Say, I am wrong, Lord. I am a doubter. I've been no more. I am not believing right now. But you're going to heal me. Heal this person, Lord. Heal this woman, Lord. Heal this man, Lord. Heal this woman, Lord. Heal this baby, Lord. Heal the young girl, Lord. Heal the young boy, Lord. Oh, Lord God, King of heaven and earth, how can we sit here, Lord? This ought to bring a rapturing faith, power of God, that will shift this whole people, shift this whole audience, Lord, into a higher height out of the glory of the living God. Oh, let the devil had his hand bound on the people. Turn them loose now. Turn them loose now. Turn them loose now. Upon the promise of God that I believe in. Upon the Bible that I teach. Upon the God who proved that he is the same Bible. That proved that he is God of the Bible. After 2,000 years, he still lives among us tonight. Resurrected from the dead. The same yesterday, today, and forever. Upon the basis of his shed blood and upon the living being present after 2,000 years, I challenge the devil with all of the impotent spirit of the sickness and diseases. Turn them people, turn them loose in the name of Jesus Christ. Come out of them, hallelujah. And they might go free. They might go free. Turn loose, hallelujah. Turn loose that sinner. Turn loose that sinner. Turn loose that backslider. Let them go free. Turn loose that sinner. Turn loose the backslider. Turn loose that sick man. Turn loose that sick woman. I claim their healing. I claim their salvation. In the name of Jesus Christ. And the Son of God. Lift them. Lift them, thou fool. Lift them, thou fool. Evil, unclean spirit.
unbelief and doubt, depart from the church, depart from my people, depart from them, from this bunch of people, in the name of Jesus Christ, amen. In the name of Jesus Christ, depart from my people, by the power and authority of the world, I challenge the name of Jesus Christ, I don't come on my own, I'm not on my own, I come in the name of Jesus Christ, I can hear my Savior, I can hear my Savior, the message of the hour is true, the power of God is true, it's the voice of God for my day, I believe it, I believe it, I go in my heart, I will die believing this, I will never die ever, for everything power from this world, I have another tabernacle, destroy this temple, that's another tabernacle waiting for me, the church of the living God is free, we are free from bondage, we are free from sin, we are free from sickness, we are free from doubt, we believe the word of the living God, we hang on to the word of the living God, Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. 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 Blessed be the name of the living God. Hallelujah. 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 Let the power of the Holy Ghost come down. Let the anointing of the Holy Ghost come down. Let you fill the house of God. Let you fill the people of God. Let you be free from every sin. Let you be free from every weakness of devil. Let you be upon in the word of God. Let you be strengthened by the word of God. Let you be healed from your head to your toe. May your head to your toe obey the word of living God. May your head to your toe obey the word of living God. We are free. We are free. We are free. The gospel has set us free. The gospel has set us free. The goodness has set us free. We are free from bondage. We are free from sin. We are redeemed of the Lord. We are redeemed of the Lord. We are redeemed of the Lord. I claim the healing of my brothers and sisters in the name of Jesus Christ. I claim their success. Whatsoever they touch shall be a success. They shall live and not die. They shall never die. There is no death. There is no condemnation for us that believe in Christ Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Blessed be the name of the living God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Of God for this day. We heard his voice. We realize on the death of Elisha, there was famine in the land. The king of Israel was destroyed. They seek Elisha. Elisha said, by this time tomorrow, there'll be food. But there was a daughter of the army. I said, even if heaven was to open, there'll be no food coming. Elisha said, there'll be food, but you just won't eat it. He could not stop the good news. For the next day, 4 lepers went out and chased the armies of Syria by their footstep. And there was abundant food, except the doubter. The doubter, he had of the food now. He saw the food, but he could not consume it. For they trembled upon him because of unbelief. Lord Jesus, may we not be like that man. For we know you sent the prophet. Many people believe you sent a prophet. Have we received the message of the prophet? Are we bearing fruit of the message? For this is what you're looking for. You say, when I come back, shall I find faith? Shall I find people that believe my word? For this is the word of God for this day. This is the voice of God for this day. It is the rapturing faith made manifest. He never preached about himself. It's not about William Branham. It was never about him. He never claimed to be nobody. He never claimed to be. He was so sincere. He could tell the truth. They even pray on the dinner table, his parents. They don't even pray on the dinner table. Sacrilegiously that people do. Even from childhood, all of us. Sacrilegiously from childhood, we pray over the dinner table. But my prophet, from childhood, they didn't pray on the dinner table. But we're not looking at that. Because the word is foretold in him. That he will be the mouth of God for this day. And so the seed was there. At the appointed time, the word began to make manifest. And it can declare that this is the voice of God for this day. This is God provided way for the end time. This is the end time message. And the end time message will be the end time. And scripture, and the message becomes one, and the prayer and the prayer group becomes one, and so shall it be. For I know you are my God. I know you are my God. I know you are my lover. I know you are the giver of everything good. I know, because you are awesome God. You are wonderful God. Omnipotent God. Your children are praying. They lay hand on each other. May you come, Lord Jesus, and honor every prayer, every prayer, every prayer, every call, every cry. Honor it for your name's sake. Give us the energy to keep going. Give us the zeal to keep going. Oh, provide our need. You made a promise. I am the Lord thy God. I provide all your need. I believe your word. Your word is anchored in our heart. May it be manifest. May it be manifest. May it be manifest. Manifest yourself in the bride. Those that are not here today, Brother Juan, Brother Isaiah, Sister Veronica, you know why, Lord Jesus. Each and every one of them, Jeremiah, oh Lord Jesus, oh, we have not seen some brothers even for a long time. I bless each and every one of them in the name of Jesus Christ. Oh, Brother Saeed, I bless you in the name of Jesus Christ. Oh, Brother Gessler, I bless you in the name of Jesus Christ. Brother Christopher, I bless you in the name of Jesus Christ. Brother Stevens, I bless you and your families in the name of Jesus Christ. My God, my Lord, may all their effort never be in vain. May their cry never be in vain. May you visit each and every one of them in a special way. May they continue this journey. Brother Pedro, I bless you, my brother, in a special way. May you continue. May you be a light. May the message of the hour, may the gospel shine on you. May you be an attribute of God. May you present yourself a living tabernacle. Oh, hallelujah. My precious Lord, thank you for Brother Solomon. I know the enemy came, even tempting Saul from his leg being swollen to whatever sickness that came. But you are the Lord, his God. You have healed him. Thank you for touching Brother Solomon. I know his heart is filled with gratitude. And I know you will always be his God and be his provider and be his healer. I know. So in his heart, he will always give testimony. He will glorify your name for what you have done. Provide his need. Oh, may you visit Sister Joey. May you visit her in a special way. Remember her lovely children. Bless them. Give them the desires of their heart. Whatsoever they've done will be a blessing. May they anchor their faith upon you and they trust you. You'll be their God. You'll be their provider. You'll be their healer. Oh, my Lord, my God. Sister Marilyn is in your hand with your husband. May you strengthen my sister as she sings for joy. As she sings for joy, she enjoys your fellowship. She enjoys to be in that presence. Oh, you will not depart from her. She will be like Hannah. She will be like Hannah, the prophetess Hannah, on that day when Jesus Christ was brought to the temple. The Spirit of the Lord depended on her, and she declared, my eyes have seen the glory of the living God. May it be the testimony of Sister Marilyn as she begins to testify, to glorify your name in whatsoever she doeth. We glorify your name. Sister Claudia, she's in your hand with her family. My Lord, my God, my precious Lord, you that gave her enough revelation to receive her baptism. May the Holy Spirit baptism always be her portion. May her children see a revival in her life. May her life bring a revival in her family. And when they see her, they see Jesus Christ. When they see her, they see Jesus Christ. May her life be Jesus Christ. May her life be Jesus Christ. Oh my God, my Lord, my God, my mother is in your hand. Oh, Sister Joy, Sister Joy, Sister Joy, Obiano, Sister Joy, Obiano, Aibonem, my God, my Lord, you that created her, you that separated her from her mother's womb, you that have touched her, she touched the hem of your garment, she will never be the same again. I realize when she was giving birth to her children, she died many times, and you resurrected her. When she gave birth to Esther, my sister, she died. You brought her back. When she gave back to Okechukwu, she died. And you brought her back. You gave her the mind. When her husband died, she lost her mind. You gave it back to her. This day, this moment of our life, we glorify your name. Whatever comes our way, we glorify your name. My Lord, my God, my wife is in your hand. Oh, she's nothing without you. I thank you, Lord. You bless her days of love. I thank you, Lord, for all the favor you give her. I thank you, Lord. Lord, for our sacrifice of our family. I thank you, Lord. I can thank you, Lord. I love you, Lord. Oh, Lord Jesus. Oh, Lord Jesus. Sister Joyce. Sister Joyce. A woman of honor. Sister Joyce. She lost her family. Sister Joyce. Her family be a blessing. Her children will be a blessing. Oh, what about those lovely children? Oh, my Lord, my God. What about Brother Patrick? Oh, my precious Lord. My precious brother. May you continue to energize him. May you continue to bless him. Give him strength and strength. Make a better way for him, my Lord. One glorious day. We don't have to live too much. We just go in the field. We just take this gospel. We just pray the good news. Somebody needs to hear the good news. Somebody needs to hear the good news. Jesus is risen. Jesus is alive. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. My Lord, my God. My nephew, my brother Dennis. May you continue to bless him. May you anchor your strength in him. May you continue to reveal yourself in him. May you continue to reveal your presence. May you continue to show him, Lord. Oh, this message of the hour. It will occupy a man's heart. It will never be the same again. Bless my brother. I thank you, Lord. I'll give him the strength to be here. Thank you for him and the help he gives to my mother. Bless my Dennis. Oh Jesus. Oh Jesus. These young children, Lord, is growing up in this day. May you be with them. May you protect them, Lord. Father. Father. The chariot of Israel. Father, I am in your hand. The church of the living God is in your hand. May you have mercy. May you rekindle your word. May you come to pass your promises upon your children.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you. Thank you for the message of the hour. Thank you for the life of William Mary Graham. Beyond the curtain of time, he saw us. One glorious day, when it's all said and done, but this time is all over. Sister Veronica Jeremiah, may the child gain the weight that's expected of the child. I want to see Jeremiah. Thank you for the answer. Say all that he has fellowship. When Friday time comes, he leaves his job by revelation and runs down here. Bless the children. May you pay him mightily.
Thank you. We pray with thanksgiving. In the name of Jesus Christ.